Supreme, Bait, Antisocial Social Club. They all have one thing in common. Not that they're all average today, but that they all would not be if it wasn't for this one brand. As a matter of fact, the entire streetwear industry derives from this one brand, Stussy, where everything started. James Jebbia, founder of Supreme. Meek Lurk, founder of Antisocial Social Club. Hiroshi Fujiwara, the godfather of streetwear. All have either worked at Stussy or been influenced directly by the brand. In today's video, we go over the history of the first and arguably the greatest streetwear brand of all time. The brand that created a world where many cultures and subcultures could peacefully coexist. How did this guy unintentionally create a brand that would revolutionize the entire clothing business? How did Stussy manage to stay relevant for so long, and what is even left of it today? Well, all of these questions will be answered in today's video. Let's get into it. Welcome back to a new video, and today we are talking about the first ever streetwear brand. It's a brand that is well respected and praised around the fashion world, but has seemingly been worn by fewer and fewer people over the years. Like many brands, it seems that Stussy has become the victim of its own success over time. But let's not skip steps, and let's start where it all began. Originally, streetwear was a way to describe comfortable clothing, predominantly worn by people following skateboarding and surf culture in Los Angeles. It's really important to acknowledge that streetwear is a byproduct of wider subcultural movements like hip-hop and skateboarding. So what we now call streetwear has been evolving since the 1970s, and is mainly credited to this guy. Born in 1954, Sean Stussy grew up immersed in surf culture on the west coast of California. At the age of 13, he began shaping his own surfboards, and not even 2 years later, he picked up a job doing just that. By his later teenage years, he had built a reputation around town as a skilled shaper of boards. Fast forward a decade later in the early 80s, Stussy was born, but it wasn't a clothing brand yet. Sean had finally opened his own surfboard shaping store and used his last name as the business name. Stussy's shift from surfing boards to clothing would happen almost by accident. See, in order to make his boards more distinguishable, he decided to scribble his surname signature on his work. He also began screen printing t-shirts with the Stussy logo on them to promote his store. In the summer of 1982, he attended a trade show to sell his shop merchandise. His plan was to donate a free t-shirt to anybody buying a surfboard. But people started to gravitate more toward the t-shirts than they did to the surfboards. He kept refusing to sell the t-shirts alone until someone offered to buy 24 of them at once.
I'm gonna make him an offer he can't refuse.
This time, it was an offer that he just could not refuse. He accepted and started selling the t-shirts right after that. Within the next 3 days, he ended up selling more than 1,000 t-shirts, while only selling 24 surfboards. That's when he understood that he had something with great potential on his hands. It took him 2 years to get everything ready, and in 1984, with the help of his friend, Frank Sinatra Jr. Oh, no, he's not related to the musicians. But together, they began selling Stussy as a clothing brand.
Pants and shirts, and jackets and hats.
It's basically baseball caps and t-shirts and jeans.
There's some corduroys, yes. There's leather jackets. There's a lot of hats.
The brand arrived at a perfect time. It grew up at a time when many cultural shifts were taking place. Punk had just arrived and broke down creative barriers, both in music and in clothing and lifestyle. In addition, punk taught that anyone could start a band, for better or for worse. The early 1980s also brought rap to the music scene. This too broke down these creative barriers. All these new ideas and areas created a new modern platform for fashion and cultural expression. Stussy was inspired by this, which led to a series of underground subcultures being appealed to by the brand. Hip-hop, punk, reggae, graffiti, and skating, they could all find common ground at Stussy's. Many other things did set Stussy apart from other brands. The first one being the quality of the clothes. Not only that, but the quality came at a reasonable price. Today, we live in a world where you have to be expensive for people to see value in your product because most people equate price to quality. But back then, Stussy was focused on their brand, and they didn't spend millions on advertisements. They knew they had a dedicated fan base, and they also knew that all they had to do was satisfy those customers, and they would come back. At that, Stussy refused to outsource its distribution, as they wanted to control and choose their customers. So their items were only sold in their stores, which at the time was a thing only done by high-end fashion brands. They also kept innovating over the years, being one of the first brands to integrate accessories into their collections as their hats became really popular. As mentioned previously, Sean Stussy wasn't a big fan of huge advertisement campaigns, so the brand relied a lot on people talking about it. And talk they sure did. By the end of the decade, Stussy was iconic. Over the years, there have been countless designers who credited Stussy and its founder as their introductions to clothing and their inspirations. Luca Benigni, founder of Slam Jam, Russell Simmons, the guy behind Fat Farm, Kim Jones of Dior, and a few others. But none is more important to streetwear than James Jeppia of Supreme, who began as a manager at Stussy's, and Hiroshi Fujiwara, the man behind Fragment and the guy responsible for introducing streetwear to Japan. He named Stussy as his biggest inspiration. Hiroshi Fujiwara made the brand so big in Japan that to this day, the brand still has a huge following there. In 1996, Sean Stussy abruptly left the brand, saying that he wanted to spend more time with his family in Hawaii. This is usually where everything falls apart for a brand, but not for Stussy. Not just yet. Even though it did lose some popularity after Sean's departure, Frank Sinatra Jr., co-founder of the brand, he hired a new team with the likes of Paul Middleman, who revived the brand very quickly by connecting it to the growing skateboarding movement of the time. This turned out to be a great move and led to many iconic collabs over the years, but even that could not stop the collapse of the brand later on. I love Stussy, but I don't really want to wear Stussy. Something Frank Sinatra could recall hearing from people. The late 90s and early 2000s saw the rise of many new streetwear brands, leading to Stussy's devolution. It became like the toy people outgrew and stopped playing with. Seeing the lack of enthusiasm around the brand, Sinatra outsourced the distribution of it. Now it was in every mall. This meant more money, for sure, but it also meant an immense drop in popularity. The brand slowly faded away after that. And this is the end of today's video.
Psych!
A few years ago, the Sinatra family pulled Stussy from all stores and now has full control over it once again. Their latest collection, it's pretty good. We are waiting to see what will happen in the future. Do I think the brand will make a comeback? Probably. I think it will eventually happen. As for Sean Stussy, after he left the brand, he continued to make surfboards. What do you think? Is there anything I missed about Stussy's history? Is it the greatest streetwear brand ever? Give me your opinions in the comments, and I'll see you next week with a new video.